東京旅行ですか。
Thank you. Thank you. that wing, and they're going to begin rounding out to that tail and clearing it down. So center of protein is sort of lost. The body's not expecting to break it. The next thing that's going to happen, you have that from the start, is the protein is going to move downward.
Now, there's also a lot of phosphorylation during the enzyme, that's the ABCC,
location only 2-1. Someone has a set of substrates, and those substrates can't bind on their own. Here's the example substrate up here, because they don't have perfect complementarity with the binding site. But Morrison, in effect, makes them whole. It rounds out a new configuration, so now you have a nice binding of the substrate to the enzyme and the rest. And in that matter, Watson is a co-ligand that stimulates degradation. There's also pseudo-substrate inhibitors that mimic a substrate that makes them kind of lysine, so they can't be equivalent for time period, so they can just clot on the enzyme. And there's also examples of allosteric regulation where it's far out in the case of a box down here that's far out from the line of the exploring part of the ligand shown here and causes it to undergo conformational change and move out of the way to allow substrate to bind. And there's some examples of that form of regulation as well. And there's many others that I'm not going to describe here, but just to give you a flavor of how complicated the regulation is. Now, I'd like to go through examples of how different signaling systems can work together, how the different systems can work to control a complex biological outbreak. And this example here, which is derived from one of the labs, a number of labs that I came down here, about 15 or so years ago, is trying to understand how each cell goes from the G1 phase of the cell cycle to the S phase of the cell cycle, which one of the replicated DNA. Now, key factor replicated DNA is an S phase cyclic complex that's going to activate the replication proteins. That's produced in G1 phase, but the minute it's produced, it's shut off. It's shut off by binding of a CDK inhibitor that's known as SLC1 or SIP1. Now, at that same time, there's a different second CDK complex in the G1 part of the DNA, and that complex is active and it's not subject to inhibition by SIP1. In fact, quite the opposite, the G1 part of the CDK phosphorylates the SIP1 protein, and that phosphorylation is depicted up here as these yellow spheres. And once the SIP1 is phosphorylated, the phosphates are epitopes, if you will, or an SCN ubiquitin ligase that then binds those phosphates and elaborates the ubiquitin chain on the SIP1 protein. The proteasome then does this remarkable feat of gymnastics, where it can grab that ubiquitin chain and slip the SIP1 off the cyclic CDK complex without harming it at all. In fact, it releases the cyclic CDK complex in active form and destroys the SIP1. And in this manner, phosphorylation and ubiquitin agents collaborate hand-in-hand to drive the essential transition to cell cycle. And a very similar process occurs in human cells with a similar set of proteins. Now, another example, this is a very critical in human physiology, concerns how your tissue sense oxygen. And this is very important because if you have insufficient oxygen, two things need to happen. First of all, you need to reduce the production of more red blood cells. And second of all, you need to increase the production of more capillaries, more blood vessels, to supply oxygen to the tissues that are deprived of oxygen. And the way this works is there's a key transcription factor. There's actually two. I'm just showing one here. N1, alpha, and N2. N stands for hypoxia and neutrophil factor. Now, these transcription factors normally are barely detectable in a typical cell. And the reason they're barely detectable is that there's an enzyme called chromophagocytosis that uses regular oxygen to hydroxylate a protein on those transcription factors on N1 alpha as well. That hydroxylated protein, which I've denoted here, serves as a direct ligand for ubiquitin ligase, known as VHL ubiquitin ligase. That then transfers ubiquitin onto the hydroxylated protein, and then the hydroxylated protein.